Well, speaking of a disconnect, there's been a lot of attention in recent days on the U.S. Commercial press to this money that Iran was sending to Afghanistan, as if this is an enormous shock. But I mean, I think of it this way. Here is Iran with U.S. troops occupying Iraq on one border and with U.S. troops occupying Afghanistan on its other border. So Iran, if anything, would feel surrounded by U.S. troops and would have some interest in what happens there. But what is your sense of how the Afghanis regard Iran or its involvement in any way in terms of what's going on in Afghanistan?
Well, I mean, frankly, a few bags of cash from delivered by Iranians pale in comparison to that. We palletize the money that we bring into the airport to give to the Afghan government. So to say that the problem that the problem of foreign intervention in domestic politics in Afghanistan is a problem of Iran is just is laughable. I mean, and Afghans understand that as well. Afghans don't talk about, or no Afghans that we talk to talked about problems with Iran in meddling in their politics. They're worried about the U.S. and they're worried about Pakistan. I mean, so yeah, this is clearly a diversion.
I want to ask you about this. This is from McClatchy. U.S. claims of Afghan peace talks a psychological operation, says an official. New doubts are being raised over reports the Obama administration's backing peace talks between the Afghan government and the Taliban. U.S. officials have claimed they've allowed senior Taliban leaders to enter Afghanistan for meetings with Afghan leaders, with some even flying aboard a NATO aircraft. But McClatchy newspapers report several U.S. officials and experts see the claims as part of an information strategy to sow division within the Taliban, and that the no significant talks are underway. One U.S. official said this is a psychological operation, plain and simple.
Well, look, I mean, General David Petraeus is like, living in Oz when he's speaking, holds these press conferences about how they're clearing out Kandahar, they're taking the battle to the heart of the Taliban. The Taliban are winning. They're winning. Their numbers are growing. They don't need to go to the negotiation table with the United States. They're defeating the United States military in Afghanistan right now. When we talk to Mullah Zaif, when we talk to a Taliban commander on the ground, they're saying, we're different from you. We have ideology. You can't figure out how to define victory. Victory for us is two things, freedom or martyrdom. And if we die in the cause of freedom, we've won. So the point is that these guys are saying, we've never heard of something called the Quetta Shura, as Mullah Zaif said to us. That's something that you created in the American media. We have shuras or meetings all the time in Peshawar and in Quetta. Maybe Mullah Omar is walking around Afghanistan. You have no idea. We're ghosts to you. And that's what this Taliban commander from Kunduz that we interviewed said. He's like, we're like ghosts. You can never see us. And then all of a sudden, boom, your vehicle is blown up. I mean, the reality is the Taliban are not in a position where they're being forced to the negotiating table. If anything, it's the U.S. that's being forced to try to find a way out of Afghanistan, because the Taliban are gaining strength. And there's other groups rising up that aren't even under the control of Mullah Omar. The insurgency is spreading. We talked to the former foreign minister for the Taliban, Muta Wakil, and he said, what you're seeing is classic guerrilla insurgency right now in Afghanistan. It's starting in the rural areas. It's spreading to the smaller cities. It's going into the district centers, and eventually it's going to hit the capital city. And he was saying that this is all the making of the Americans. Well, the Taliban will negotiate with the Afghan government if the U.S. leaves.
I'd like to ask you about WikiLeaks, which has come under criticism from the Pentagon for releasing the nearly 400,000 classified military documents on the war in Afghanistan. This is what General Stanley McChrystal, the former commander of U.S. and NATO forces in Afghanistan, who also ran special operations during the surge in Iraq, had to say about the Iraq war logs on the eve of their release.
I think, first, the decision by anybody to leak classified information is something that not only is it illegal, it's also something that individual is making judgments about the value of that information and the threat to comrades that almost nobody is qualified to make that judgment. So if somebody leaks information that puts me or one of my soldiers at risk, I think that's a level of irresponsibility that's very upsetting. Then there's the decision to release them widely. I also am not comfortable with that either. I think that a level of responsibility towards our people needs to be balanced with any argument for a need or right to know. I can't judge every single piece of information. I wouldn't try to. But I would say that there has to be that balance and there has to be that level of maturity, because it's likely that the leak of some of that information could cause death of our own people or some of our allies.
That was the General Stanley McChrystal talking about the 400,000 documents that have been leaked by WikiLeaks on Iraq this time. The last batch, the 76,000 or so, were on Afghanistan. And this was on the eve of this release, the largest release of military documents in the U.S. in U.S. history. Jeremy Scahill, Rick Rowley, you guys were in Afghanistan when this happened. What is your response? A lot of this, of these documents, show the privatization of the military and what's happening.
Well, I mean, first of all, regarding Blackwater and other military companies, these documents show that the State Department was fully aware that Blackwater was killing civilians while guarding U.S. diplomats. And actually, one of the documents indicates that the State Department chose not to discipline or go after Blackwater because they said it would hurt Blackwater's morale, which just gives you a sense of the calculus that was being done while the Bush administration was running things in Iraq. In the bigger picture, a lot of focus has been put on, did the U.S. know that Iraqis were torturing detainees? The U.S. was torturing detainees. The entire policy of the Bush administration under Rumsfeld was to outsource torture, the extraordinary rendition, the secret prisons, Camp Nama, in Iraq, which was a secret prison where people were mercilessly and systematically tortured. The other thing that was revealed, and Rick has done a lot of work on this and can speak to it, is the whole myth that the surge is what stabilized Iraq, when in reality it was a death squad policy that the U.S. was implementing there.
Rick Rowley.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, as with the Afghan leaks, the Iraq leaks don't tell us crazy new things that weren't being reported by good, unembedded journalists who were doing investigative work on the ground. But they reinforce that work, and they show that the military was actively lying, that the military knew what was going on and was actively lying about it and deliberately misleading the media, so that while the truth might have been out there in some sort of alternative outlets like Democracy Now!, it was systematically undermined in the mainstream media. So the surge is a kind of prime example of this. The key sort of takeaway points are that violence was already declining due to the, you know, sort of the ending of the civil war in Iraq before the surge troops arrived. The place where the U.S. was facing the majority of its casualties up to that point was in Anbar province. None of the surge troops went to Anbar province. They all went to the capital. What happened was at the end of an exhausting sectarian civil war where the Shia had basically purged the Sunni out of Baghdad, the U.S. brings its surge in at a point where there are no longer any mixed neighborhoods left in Baghdad. It's all pure Sunni and pure Shiite. They've turned into armed enclaves and ghettos inside a city that are fighting against each other. And the surge troops went in and reinforced the boundaries between those communities. They were patrolling the borders, putting concrete walls around, walling people in. I mean, that was the energy behind the decrease in violence.
Well, we want to thank you both for being with us and raising this issue on the eve of the midterm elections, an issue that is hardly raised in any debate on any of the agenda-setting talk shows on television, the issue of war when this country is engaged in at least two of them.
Well, I mean, the Democrats have no credibility on the Afghanistan war. They've continued to fund it. They support it with rhetoric about women's rights and pulling the burqa off. They could have gone to town on the fiscal irresponsibility of this war and captured some of the energy that permeates the Tea Party movement, but they have no credibility on it. And I think that's one of the reasons why you see so little energy from Democrats right now.
And for folks who want to see our coverage on the midterm elections from 8 until 2 in the morning Eastern time, you can go to our website at democracynow.org. This is Democracy Now! We'll be back in a minute. Thank you very much, Jeremy Scahill and Rick Rowley. Jeremy's piece we will link to at the Nation website. It's called Killing Reconciliation, his book Blackwater, the rise of the world's most powerful mercenary army. Stay with us. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Well,